Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. As we bid farewell to April 2023, let us take a moment to reflect on the fact that one-third of 2023 is already done and dusted, and that cozy little pocket of time at the beginning of the year that you had planned to work diligently through, accomplishing many useful and long-delayed tasks, has passed you by. March and April basically ghosted us, and part of me wonders if they even happened at all, or if those 2 months were just made up by the calendar printing companies to lure us into a false sense of tranquility before thrusting the rest of the year upon us. And the force of that thrusting is to be felt throughout today's news. We have scandalous reports of dying Ryzen 7000 series CPUs, a steadily increasing flow of rumors about next-gen red and green GPUs expected in the next month or two, AAA games launching alongside a new generation of handheld consoles, and we are about 1 month from Computex now, which will showcase countless new gadgets while also kicking off the unofficial start of summer already. I'm still waiting to see if the calendar-making people can add another month or two to each year designated for just relaxing and doing as little as possible, but until then, let's get you up to speed with this week's tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Micro Center. This is one of my favorite places to buy PC parts. So if you're building or upgrading your PC, I highly recommend making your way down to one of their 25 retail stores in the US. They have consistently competitive prices and an excellent selection of PC hardware and other tech goodies. And they have a custom PC builder on the Micro Center website. Use it to spec out your rig and it will show you parts in store at your nearest location while ensuring compatibility. Then you can pick up in store or have their pros assemble it for you. So click the sponsor link in the description to find a Micro Center near you. Early adopters of new PC hardware, and particularly newly launched platforms like AM5, make a trade-off. They're able to experience the latest and fastest consumer technology on the market, but along with that comes the cost of premium launch prices and the risk of an undiscovered problem cropping up after units make their way to the mass market. So I wouldn't blame anyone who purchased a Ryzen 7000 CPU in the past 7 months since launch for being nervous as events unfolded over the past week. It began with reports of Ryzen 7000 X3D CPUs dying or burning out late last week, with physical damage from excessive heat appearing as bubbles on the LGA side of the CPU or as burn marks on the corresponding pins on the motherboard socket. More failure reports trickled in over the weekend, and then a megathread was set up on the AMD subreddit on Tuesday to collect and sort information that came to light. AMD officially responded late Tuesday night that they were aware of the issue and investigating it, and motherboard manufacturers began chiming in shortly afterward to reassure everyone that they were also taking action to help affected customers and push out UEFI updates to prevent it happening in the future. Fast forward to Thursday, and AMD says they've figured it out. The SoC voltage was too damn high, or could be in certain situations, and a new AGESA version 1.0.7.0 that caps SoC voltage at 1.3 volts is now being seeded to motherboard partners so they can issue updated UEFIs for affected boards. Further digging into the AGESA changes by Igor's lab also revealed that temperature control parameters were adjusted too, so it's likely that other factors were in play along with the SoC voltage. This could also explain why there were Ryzen 7000 non-X3D chips that were reported to have died as well. While the newer X3D chips are more susceptible to this issue, non-X3D variants have reportedly bit the dust too. So to be safe, it's recommended that pretty much all AM5 users update their UEFIs once versions are made available with that new AGESA microcode, and if you haven't updated yet, you might consider disabling expo memory settings, which can affect SoC voltages in some cases, as well as disabling manual overclocks and rolling back your UEFI if you're on an alpha or beta version. Remember that there's still a very limited number of failed CPUs so far, so for most, this will just be a precaution, but I'm also keen to hear what Gamers Nexus has to say on the subject, as they've been investigating all week and even managed to kill their Ryzen 7800X 3D in the process. If Steve's video is up on this subject by the time my video goes live, I'll link it in the description below. The mid-range GPU market could use a swift kick in the nuts, or perhaps that's just how we feel the mid-range GPU market has been treating us. But if we haven't completely given up hope, there might be at least a few more options in that category soon. An unverified rumor relayed by videocards.com says the Radeon RX 7600 XT has a release date which could be May 25th, just 5 days shy of when Computex kicks off. The rumor comes from Moore's Law is Dead, and also says samples will go out to reviewers on May 15th, with a review embargo set for one day prior to launch on May 24th. Since the 7600 XT would only be the third card to launch in the RX 7000 series lineup, there's still a lot of questions as to its specs, as well as the RX 7700 and 7800, which we presume will exist at some point too. Currently, we're expecting a Navi 33-based card with 8 gigs of VRAM, a 2.6 GHz boost clock, and a 175 watt TDP that could outperform the 6650 XT by upwards of 10% on average, again according to rumors. If this card is priced well, perhaps in the $250 to $300 range, it could provide a current gen option for builders whose entire PCs cost as much as a 7900 XT or RTX 4070 Ti. Nvidia will probably also be launching an 8GB mid-range card in the same time frame though, as we already teased last week with some early RTX 4060 Ti rumors. Well now, Megasize GPU on Twitter has revealed a picture of the AD106-350A1 GPU that will probably power the 4060 Ti, although that's pretty much all that's new to say about it. We're still looking for this card to launch in May, and hopefully we'll see a reasonable price from Nvidia too, and I base that hope on absolutely nothing. AMD officially announced the Ryzen Z1 series of processors on Wednesday, which integrate Zen 4 cores and RDNA 3 graphics and are meant for use in handheld gaming devices like the Asus ROG Ally, which was foolishly announced on April 1st. The Ryzen Z1 will kick off with two variants, the standard Z1, which sports a 6-core CPU and 4 RDNA 3 compute units, and the Z1 Extreme, which ships with 8 cores, 12 GPU compute units, and presumably a zipline and a wingsuit. Asus appears to have worked out a temporary launch exclusive with AMD for their ROG Ally handheld gaming device, which now has a confirmed launch date of May 11th and a rumored price of $700. And that's for the version with the higher-end Z1 Extreme processor. That's going to provide some serious competition for the Steam Deck, to say nothing of other potential handheld gaming devices based on the Z1 that may launch in the future. The ROG Ally has some nice benefits over the Steam Deck on paper at least, such as a 7-inch 1080p 120Hz screen, a quieter fan, and faster charging via a 65-watt USB-C charger. It also runs Windows natively, and at least according to AMD's benchmarks, provides a solid gaming experience across the titles that they tested, both at 720 with Radeon Super Resolution upscaling, or natively at 1080p. Have I mentioned that there was a metric butt-ton of news to cover this week? Good thing we're moving on to tech briefs, which are double-seamed and reinforced to handle the load. Star Wars Jedi Survivor launched on Friday, and the contrast was striking when comparing console reviews to PC. The game is, reportedly, quite good if you play on Xbox or PlayStation, where EA and Respawn Entertainment apparently focused all of their optimization efforts. The PC story is not as rosy, however, as multiple users have complained of crashes, graphical issues, and an unexpected error that glitches you past important story elements. And this is after they downloaded a 128GB launch day patch, and also aside from general performance issues like a top-tier RTX 4090-based system only managing to push out 60 to 80 frames per second. It's already public knowledge that the game was produced in record time, so some oversights were bound to happen, but apparently ignoring PC performance entirely has caused enough backlash to prompt a public statement from EA. They're sorry, and they're going to patch it, probably at an indeterminate point in the future. And what possible reason could we have for not taking EA at their word? I briefly showed MSI's RTX 3060 Ti Super 3X graphics card last week, and at the time I thought, that's a bold move, MSI. Make a new 3060 Ti, either 1 or 3 years after its initial launch, depending on if you're counting the GDDR6X version, and call it Super 3X, clearly attempting to trick some consumers into thinking it's a new GPU or a variant akin to the second round of Super Series GPUs that Nvidia launched when they were still on the RTX 20 series. Unsurprisingly, Nvidia wasn't happy with that move, and MSI has now recalled all of the RTX 3060 Ti Super 3X graphics cards from retail channels in China and Taiwan. Nice try, MSI, but next time call it something that won't get you in trouble, like the RX RTX 3060 Ti XT. Speaking of massive recalls, I can't recall the last time Intel's earnings report looked this bad. Q1 2023 revenue for the tech giant was down 36% year over year, the largest quarterly dip in company history, dropping from $18.4 billion in 2022 to $11.7 billion in 2023. As Anantech points out, though, there's a lot more going on than the headlines reveal, such as unprecedented earnings back in 2021 and 2022, coupled with an ongoing economic downturn in 2023. Current CEO Pat Gelsinger also just took the reins in 2021, so his initiatives and business decisions will have more of an impact as time goes on. Intel absolutely needs to answer AMD back in the server and data center market, but there's reason for optimism as they look to bring new products to market in 2023 and 2024. One of those new products will probably be Meteor Lake CPUs, and on Monday, this image was dug up directly from the Intel website by momomo_us on Twitter. It's an LGA 1851 interposer, which would be used for testing and validation of next-gen socket LGA 1851 motherboards and, presumably, Meteor Lake S desktop CPUs. Rumors abound, but confirmed details are scarce for what Intel has planned. There might still be another Raptor Lake CPU refresh coming for LGA 1700 in Q3, and when 14th gen eventually launches, it's unknown whether desktop or mobile chips will be first out of the gate. Tom's Hardware currently predicts that we won't see desktop Meteor Lake until 2024. In closing, we have another nefarious way to use AI and deepfakes, not to directly impersonate someone or spread misinformation, but simply as a lame excuse. You see, since deepfakes exist, then anything could be a deepfake. Even statements that Elon Musk made about Tesla self-driving capabilities as far back as 2016, when deepfakes actually did not exist yet. But that didn't stop his legal team from making that argument anyway, and suggesting that Elon shouldn't be accountable for the words he said because, since he's famous, maybe someone just made that video with deepfakes. If true, that would conveniently allow the billionaire to live in a fanciful realm of semi-reality, where he can say or do anything he wants without any repercussions or responsibility. Fortunately, the judge swatted this one down pretty quickly, but I'm sure this won't be the first time this defense is attempted. The future sure looks bright for really, really rich people. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. You can also check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.